I've given talks on previous conferences about it, but the state right now is what I was aiming at all the time. So what is the problem space that we're trying to address with CRIPR? I guess I don't have to elaborate on that too much because everyone in the room should know that, but just be on the same page. Imagine you have a production database that is storing its data on zero.var.dbpg, and you want to backup that database to your backup server. And this hopefully somewhere offsite or something. So what are you going to have to do to achieve that? Obviously, you need to take snapshots in some form or another. So some form of snapshot management, that means taking that snapshot. And then we need some way to figure out which snapshots need to be transferred in which way. So do we have to do a full replication or can we do incremental replication? So this is essentially boils down to building some kind of diff. Again, that's fairly simple because we can only do forward or do a rollback and then go forward again. But in order to do that, we need to talk between these two sides. So we need some kind of remote procedure calls. So yeah, from the basic idea is like this. So we have CFS list on the other side, do a diff and be done with that. Then we need to coordinate send and receive on both sides. So once we figured out what to transfer, we need to start CFS send on one side, CFS receive on the other side, and then have some transport mechanism that is remotely efficient at least. So do CFS send, receive, and voila, first snapshot is there. The more interesting part is that usually in these kind of backup scenarios, you don't want it to happen just once, but you want that continuously. So continuous operation of the whole thing is important, and the tool of choice for many Unix people is cron. I kind of don't like waking up in the morning and seeing that my internet provider cut the connection once at night, and then I get some email because the shell script failed early, never retried. So I was kind of fed up with that and tried to do something better. So yeah, again, probably too much animation steps here. So what we see here is also not just creating snapshots, but also pruning snapshots and maybe also using bookmarks. So in case we get a gap in the replication, we can still resume with an incremental replication. So even more snapshots, fine. To go further, this was just one single file system. What I usually want to do is not just one file system, but I want to back up an entire machine. So if I have a database server there, there might also be configuration files that are relevant for backup, or I store virtual machines in zVaults, and basically I want to have the same thing that I just showed for a single data set to happen for multiple data sets. Also, we have gained a lot of new features in the last years. So resumable send and receive is probably the biggest one, in particular if you have flaky network connections or even it just fails once every week or so. If your replications take long, it's very nice to have support for that. And right now, not so many tools do. There are also other send flags like compressed send receive, deduplicated send and receive, which have the same problem as resumable send and receive in that they require they require support on both sides. So there are interoperability concerns, and a tool that wants to support this stuff usually needs to or should figure out on its own what is supported on both sides, what can we do, and then use those features as possible. Untrusted receivers, this is interesting with regards to the encryption patch that is, I think, going to land in the next stable release of CS on Linux. So being able to ship your backups to a third-party storage service that you do not necessarily trust is quite valuable. And right now, the tooling support for raw send and receive is kind of not there. And from the operational aspects, it's kind of my biggest motivation why I just didn't write another shell script that suits my needs. I want to know what the software is doing that is handling my data. So in particular, when something goes wrong, I want to see logs. I want to see what this application was doing, what led to the failure, and ideally how it recovered. There's also the aspect of monitoring, so being able to point your monitoring infrastructure at the software that is doing the replication and see that things are actually happening the way they're supposed to be, and maybe also seeing how much data was transferred and optionally alerting on that. And the last aspect is probably the biggest one, software maintenance. So I think we have a few, several thousand line shell scripts lying around there, and I think it is kind of a fact that these are not really maintainable. So in particular with regards to testability of certain stuff, if you're good at shell, maybe you're comfortable with that. I am not. I think there's definitely room for improvement there, in particular if the features that CFS provides are still evolving and we want to adapt the software to use that. So my stance is the CFS command line is great, and the Unix tools are all great, and they're great for the specific one-offs that you want to do. Like if you have a specific setup, do that. But what zRepl aims to be is a general purpose solution. So that is able to adapt to changing requirements. Okay, so this is kind of the motto that I thought about it. It should be integrated in that you have a single tool to go to that does all the replication aspects for you, does the snapshot management, does it implement the actual replication, and that be easy to use for novice users who just want to get their backups configured and not worry about that afterwards. And the long-term maintainability of the software kind of goes hand-in-hand with that, because I think with the changing feature landscape, this is very relevant. So how does it work? zRepl runs as a daemon on both sides of the replication setup. So you start that daemon, and then these daemons talk to each other using a well-defined RPC protocol instead of just running SSH commands and running ZFS on the other side. So this all communication is guided through that RPC protocol. Replication basically has two modes. So one goal during the development was that both push and pull mode are supported without any code duplication. So if you architect the software just right, actually these slides are not the version that I have on my laptop right now. So I fixed those yesterday. Let's just improvise, because I'm a bit tight on time. So, okay. The goal of the replication setup was to not have any code duplication, because then it's easier to maintain that single code path that does the replication. And the way this is implemented is that we decouple the replication logic from the actual RPC interfaces. So we have a replicator that is basically implementing the replication logic, like building the diff and then coordinating the send and receive. And it will do that by talking to an abstract sender and receiver. And the nice thing is that we can either instantiate that replicator on the pushing side, so for example on my laptop, which I want to back up, or we can instantiate that replicator on the receiving side. And by just gluing the right endpoints, which is how we call this, at the right fields, we get this nice symmetry. So what this boils down to is we have a sender that is local, and a receiver that is an RPC stub that then calls to the target where the actual endpoint is. And if we do pull mode, it's just the reverse. So yeah, we deduplicated that replication logic successfully. Again, this, I'm sorry. This is not how these slides should look like. Okay, so what we saw, here, this little cloud is the different transport mechanisms. So we use this RPC protocol, but it's not tied to a specific transport. So you can use plain TCP, you can use TLF with client authentication, or you can use SSH if you do not want to expose the software directly to the internet. The SSH thing is kind of a neat hack that is not that performant as TLS or plain TCP, but as said, it does allow you to not expose zRepl directly to the internet. The way it works is that the zRepl daemon that wants to connect to the other side will issue start an SSH command that then connects to the SSHD on the remote host. And using a forced command, we basically enforce that this SSH pub key that is connecting can only ever start this single zRepl standard in server command. And the hack that then happens is that this zRepl standard in server command connects to the zRepl daemon via a Unix socket and then passes its standard in and standard out file descriptors to that zRepl daemon. And the zRepl daemon will create a connection object that is using the standard in of the SERPIL standard in server process that it was passed on write and the standard out on read. So to the daemon, this kind of proxied SSH connection looks exactly the same as any plain TCP or TLS client auth. So you're flexible with the transports, depending on whether performance is more important to you or maybe, yeah, not exposing CRP to the internet. The RPC protocol that is built on top of these transports is homegrown. I'm not really content with that, but I didn't find any better solution. So the problem is that we're going to send large amounts of data over that protocol, and we have this special property that we do not know the size of the ZFS send stream in advance, like at least not precisely. So the problem that I was facing with other generic RPC protocols is that you are not in control of memory allocation in most of these RPC servers, and that leads to a lot of overhead that can be avoided if you write a protocol that respects this specific need. So the idea is that you have a little header that basically contains the endpoint, which is the function name that you're going to call, and then you can pass structured data, which you know the size when sending the request, and then you can attach a stream that is composed of individual chunks. And so obviously the stream part is for ZFS send stream. This can go in both directions. And the structured part is protocol buffer messages that are hopefully future compatible. At least that was the decision where we used that. So on this, Matt, is there any chance that we can get the new slides? So I was hoping, because it looks...
Yeah. Let's, it should be linked to your... I can make sure that we open it again from your... what you sent with me.
Matt at Delphix.
Yeah. This is a live demo of Google Mail.
Matt at Delphix?
Yeah, that works. Everyone's going to see my emails. You can see if there's anything interesting in here. We'll try to find Christian. So, let's see if this is, maybe it got converted or something. Let's check this.
Yeah, that one, look those better? Look.
Does this look better?
Yes.
Okay, it must have got.
Just go to this slide, we'll be fine.
Okay. Yeah. Awesome. I think maybe we converted one of the like PDFs or something rather than linking to your.
Ah, okay.
This directly. Okay. Sorry about that.
Might have happened. Okay. So we talked about the RPC protocol and So the endpoints. So we basically looked at the transports and the RPC mechanism that we have, and now we have the endpoints that use the RPC mechanism to implement the actual communication on top. And the idea is that these endpoints are not just simple wrappers around the ZFS command line, like ultimately they will call the ZFS binary, but the idea is that the endpoints perform policy checks. So a sender endpoint will limit access to a list of file systems that the user whitelisted in the config file. And that by limiting that view, the replicator will only ever replicate those file systems that the user intended to replicate. So if you, for example, want to prohibit replication of a single user directory that contains sensitive data, or you want to inhibit replication of the zroot/temp file system, which is usually not that interesting for the backups, you can do that by just filtering what is presented to the replicator by a sender endpoint. On the receiving side, we again do policy checks, but this time the idea is that all interaction coming to that endpoint will be projected into a subtree of the file system. And this sounds more complicated than it is. So what you basically want to do is, on the receiving side, always limit what the caller can see to what that caller actually pushed at some point to the server. So imagine like a separate sub file system tree for each replication client. The receiver is the entity that will enforce that. And this all works by just omitting certain things from the ZFS list output or checking whether a ZFS send or ZFS receive request is actually allowed to go for that specific user. And this all works because the transport mechanism is authenticated and the receiver endpoint can check whether a given operation is allowed. The idea behind all this, just not doing SSH, but doing this properly with an RPC protocol, is multi-tenancy. So with ZFS native encryption, we already get the ability to, as a user, send data to a remote site that we do not trust. What is still missing is receiving untrusted replication streams. So this is kind of the opposite part. If you operate that single storage server that serves as a replication sync for many other sites, it is currently not really possible to receive these untrusted replication streams because you risk that the kernel will either crash or the sender will corrupt your file system. I put this up as one of the hackathon topics because I'm interested in having this multi-tenancy setup. So actually mutually untrusting users and the storage provider can use zRePL to work together. Snapshot management is what's still missing. And for that, I just brought an excerpt from the config file. So again, you see the file systems filter here. So this file systems filter says that, okay, please snapshot and replicate everything in the file system tree. So this angular bracket is kind of a wildcard operator. I need to find something that is not allowed in the ZFS file system paths. But we want to prohibit replication of zRoot/temp. We will then do the snapshotting in periodic intervals. So this is fairly simple. We prepend a snapshot prefix to a formatted date. And then the pruning is a bit more interesting. So you specify both pruning rules for keep sender and keep receiver. And the idea is that you specify a list of rules that state which snapshots are to be kept. And we build the union of these snapshot lists that are to be kept and only prune those that are not in any of these lists. So one of the more interesting fields here is the not replicated keep rule. This is implemented using a cursor bookmark that is kept on the sender, and this cursor bookmark is only advanced after a successful replication step. So once we have replicated one file systems, we advance that cursor bookmark on the sender, and this allows us to implement this keep rule by just sorting by older createTxt or newer createTxt. The most complex keep rule in the system is probably the keep receiver thing. And what you see in keep receiver, and this is called the retention grid. And it implements essentially a grandfathering schema. So the problem is because the snapshot replication must happen like one after another. We can't do different branches for daily, weekly, monthly or so. We need some way to fade history out in that one linear snapshot stream. So the idea behind it is that you specify a list of adjacent intervals that go from now into the past, and that each of these intervals has a keep count associated with it. So the idea is that at most n snapshots per interval are kept, and the default is one. So if you increase the length of each interval as you go further into the past, you will achieve this fade-out effect where fewer and fewer snapshots are kept per interval, but you still have some old snapshots in case you notice that you deleted a file 6 months ago and need to retrieve it back. Yeah, this is kind of the state where zRePL is now. What is still missing are some of the newer ZFS features, but the idea is that the infrastructure with a proper RPC protocol and configuration is there to do that. So resumable send and receive and all the other newer send and receive flags generally require support on both sides, and if both sides support it, it is often a good bet to just use it. Deduplicated maybe should think about memory usage, but Otherwise, if both sides support it, why not use it? So the idea is to have some kind of feature negotiation schema there, a little like content type and accept in HTTP. The more complex additions recently are encrypted send and receive and redacted send and receive. So encrypted send and receive will enable this multi-tenancy scenario or zero-ripple as a service, however you may call it. But again, this still requires auditing and potentially changing or at least hardening the ZFS receive path. Redacted send and receive is also interesting for backups, in particular for your laptop where you might have a lot of cache directory or build cache directories. You could basically have a schema where you, before doing the replication, do a redaction where you delete all these cache directories. I only had that idea fairly recently, but should be interesting. It also complicates the replication logic quite a bit, but for desktop users, I think it's interesting. From an operational point of view, zRipple is pretty well covered. We have extensive documentation on zRipple.github.io for the configuration format, and zRipple uses structured logging with multiple logging formats and outlets, so it if you have some existing log monitoring infrastructure, you can easily glue it up with it. There is also a zRipple status command that is currently still in the development branch, but the idea is that you can see what the replication plan is, so what the daemon is planning to do during the replication, and see progress reports, like it replicated this step, the others are still missing, and you have a nice progress bar that shows you how many bytes were transferred. If you use Prometheus, we also have a Prometheus monitoring endpoint. So if you want to monitor like the transfer volumes that you have, or even just error log counters, you're also covered there. And then you can use your existing alerting infrastructure with Prometheus to do to alerting on zRipple. So I think I'll stop at this slide then. So zRipple has the goal of long-term maintainability, and this is why I chose some kind of proper programming language to do that. It is implemented in Go, which is probably not my first choice, but for this task, it is certainly the best one. Go provides reasonable performance, at least some type safety, and you can write easy tests for the most critical code paths. So every code path that leads to a ZFS destroy is properly tested, in particular the prune rules. Yeah, last of all, great tooling, so you can easily cross-compile it to all the different supported platforms. So zRipple runs on FreeBSD, Linux, Solaris, and Darwin, which is, I guess, with the exception of ZFS on Windows, probably all platforms that are relevant. So there was a plan for a demo or tutorial, but obviously that's we didn't have much time. And since...
Okay, three questions.
Yeah, I think I will just go ahead to the questions, and these are on the hackathon topic list. Okay, any questions? Yeah?
Do you take advantage of ZFS send dash capital R, capital I, or do you manage individual send streams?
So the question was whether we use the dash capital R flag, and the answer is no. We right now do each individual file system, which probably hurts most with regards to the deduplication once we get that. And in theory, we could have a look at that, but from the discussions I had yesterday, it kind of conflicts with the goal to achieve a hardened ZFS receive path. So yeah, we'll have to do some trade-offs there. Yeah.
Does it support parallelizing sends and receives on systems that have many, many data sets?
The question was whether it supports parallelizing ZFS send and receives on systems that have many data sets. Currently not. Like there's this architecture, it would be fairly simple to just start the replication in individual Go routines. The reason why we didn't do that right now is usually, or at least my systems are IO bound, not network bound.
But the use case would be, say, a system where there might be separate home directories for 1,000 users or whatnot, each of which is in their own data set, and the changes that are sent to receive are not very large, so the bulk of the time is overhead starting and stopping the sending and receiving processes.
Yeah, so the remark was that, in particular, if you have low transfer volumes per data set but a lot of data sets, then it would be helpful to have it parallel. I think it's mostly a limitation of the current transport abstraction, because our goal was to have like everything happen on a single connection, And we'd likely need multiple TCP connections to do that. So yeah, a bit of a layering violation there, but maybe it's worth it. Any other questions? Yes? The question is whether there is a restore functionality, and no, there is not. Like, so I built it for my own personal use case, and to me it is like online backup, it is kind of a last resort. So you have the local snapshots, you specify the local prune rules, so against accidental deletion of some individual file systems, you're protected, but an automated restore is not planned right now. What is planned is a normal ZFS, a command line utility that you can use to restore individual file systems, and not use the daemon for that, because the daemon is really intended for continuous operation.